डॉक्टर शमेनास, डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ इंग्लिश, राशि टंडन महिला महाविद्यालय ऑफ अ कॉन्स्टिट्यूएंट कॉलेज ऑफ यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ इलाहाबाद इज प्रेजेंटिंग बिफोर यू पेपर 2 मॉड्यूल 27 साउथ एशियन फेमिनिज्म इंडिया पाकिस्तान एंड बांग्लादेश विच इज रिटन बाय आलिया रिफत एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ इंग्लिश काशी नरेश गवर्नमेंट पोस्ट ग्रेजुएट कॉलेज ज्ञानपुर भदोही उत्तर प्रदेश. फेमिनिज्म इन साउथ एशिया. एज वन ऑफ द लार्जेस्ट कॉन्टिनेंट ऑन अर्थ एशिया बूस्ट अप्रॉक्सीमेटली 4 बिलियंस पीपल विथ 47 कंट्रीज. ऑफ दीज साउथ एशिया अलोन इज होम टू अराउंड अ फिफ्थ ऑफ वर्ल्ड पॉपुलेशन. इट इज एन एरिया कंटेनिंग रिमार्केबल ethnic, linguistic, religious, geographical and political diversity, cultural varieties, putting ethnicity, culture, religion and borders aside. The Asian countries have similar values. All South Asian culture are basically patriarchal. The woman is less validated than her male counterpart across the Asian borders. There is a lot of values placed on the birth of a son, and one of the major problems facing the family today is the declining sex ratios, which has become a major problem in all the three countries. Gender based violence is a universal reality of the South Asian region, regardless of income, class and culture. Since the 1970s, South Asia has seen wide-ranging economic changes that have had major implications for people's livelihood strategies, whilst mainstreaming has given gender issues an unprecedented visibility in development discourses and organizations. However, the rise of feminism has resulted in a re-evaluation of women's role and position along with their contribution to society. It has been said that past 40 years, South Asia has been the location and focus of dynamic, important feminism and activism, as lots of women activists are rising in all the three countries demanding equal rights for women. Feminism in India. Feminism in India is a struggle for the establishment of equal economic, social and political opportunity for Indian women. Rights for equal wages, equal access to health and education, equal political rights, inheritance law and issue related to sati, all comes within their purview. Jasbir Jain's book Indigenous Root of Feminism analyzes the feminist movement in India in a historical perspective. She declares that feminism is more than a voice of protest or questioning. It is moral self-reflection, a conquering of inner fears and a realization of self-worth. It does not abandon values or relationship, but goes on to create new ones. The challenges that the feminist movement now faces stem from the vast diversities within India, since India being a multicultural, multi-religious and multi-ethnic country. Feminism within India is divided along class, caste, sexuality and disability, and as parts of India develop at a faster rate, increased social and economic inequality is giving rise to new problems like sexual harassment at the workplaces and in public transport, which is a continuous problem women are facing all around India. But one of the most difficult tasks for feminists is changing men's underlying attitude towards women. Vrinda Nabar, a former chairwoman of English at Mumbai University and author of Caste as Women, said, I quote, mindsets need to change at every level, and all of us need to recognize that inherited prejudices of our collective consciousness once the protester and their placards have vacated the streets. Pandita Ramabai, who is a Sanskrit scholar, a social reformer, a pioneer of women education, she spent her life to better the status of women in India. She studied and discussed issues that surrounded Indian women and spoke against the practices of child marriages. In 1989, she started a home-cum school in Bombay, which was named as Sharda Saradhan. This was the first home for widows in Maharashtra. The Pandit Ramabai Mukti Mission is still active today and in working for the upliftment of women. Ishmat Chagatai, a bold feminist writer, was a pathbreaker for women writers in the subcontinent. She was an eminent writer in Urdu and was known for her indomitable spirit and fierce feminist ideology. Ishmat's work, along with the works of Rashid Jahan, Wazida Tabassum and Kuratuleen Haider, stand for the birth of a revolutionary feminist politics and aesthetics in 20th century Urdu fiction, which are now being translated into English as well. Amrita Pritam is considered the first renowned poet, essayist and novelist of Punjabi literature. She is considered an era in the field of Indian Punjabi literature. She migrated to India from Lahore, Pakistan in 1947. She started as a poet but soon joined the progressive writer movement. Her works is loved by both India and Pakistan. The most famous of her works are Pinjar and Aaj Aankha Waarish Chaalu. Shashi Deshpande is regarded as one of the prominent contemporary writer in Indian writing English. Till date, she has written more than 11 novels, short story and other literary genre. She feels that while she is a feminist, she doesn't want her novel to be imprisoned with label. They are an open examination of the experience of people in specific setting. She does not want to be labeled herself as a feminist writer because she feels that feminism should be for a better understanding of human relationship. Her characters are intelligent, educated, urban women who speaks out, question, introspect, present in a literary microcosm the condition of women in India at large. It is suggested that the long silence is a result of patriarchy, refusal to comprehend women's language insofar as women's works, speech, act and aspiration are concerned. She is a winner of Sahitya Academy Award for her two novels. Arundhati Roy. She is a writer as well as activist who is best known for the 1997 Man Booker Prize for fiction winning novel The God of Small Things. She is also famous as a political activist involved in human rights and environmental causes. After a span of more than 20 years, her second novel has published recently. Asra Numani. Asra Numani is an Indo-American writer who is the author of Standing Alone in Mecca, An American Woman's Struggle for the Soul of Islam, and Tantrika, Traveling the Road of Divine Love. Numani became a writer, activist, dedicated to fighting for women's rights and principles of tolerance in the Muslim world. In 2003, Numani challenged rules at her mosque in Morgantown that required women to enter through a back door and pray in a secluded balcony. She was put on trial at her mosque to be banished. She was the lead organizer of the women-led Muslim prayer in New York City of America on March 18, 2005. Feminism in Pakistan. The literature in Pakistan date back to 1947, since Pakistan was formed by dividing India. There are two dominant forces of feminism in Pakistan: a modern Islamic feminism and a secular feminism. Modern Islamic feminists such as Rifat Hassan, Amina Wadud, and Asma Barlas seeks to further women's rights by redefining Islamic views of her. Secular feminism is an extension of basic human rights regardless of any religion existing in the country. Feminism in Pakistan is not entirely new. In fact, Islam was the first religion to formally grant women a status they had not enjoyed before and taught moral, spiritual, and economic equality. There are countless quotes from prominent Islamic scholars and the Quran itself about women's right regarding education, marriage, divorce, and right to own property. The real feminist struggles started in Pakistan in 1980s as a reaction to General Ziaul Haq's controversial implementation of the Hudood Ordinance, which asked rape victims to present 4 eyewitnesses for their claim to be accepted. The Women Action Forum, WMA, led by Asma Jahangir, established in 1980, opposed the unjust ruling and devised the famous Men, Money, Mullah, and Military. Bapsi Sidwa, the pioneer of Pakistani writing in English, is best known for her collaborative work with Indo-Canadian filmmaker Deepa Mehta. Sidwa wrote both the novel Ice Candyman, on which Deepa Mehta adapted a movie in 1998 named as Earth, which is about partition. Then later, Deepa Mehta made a movie Water, which was adapted by Bapsi Sidwa as a novel. The novel The Bride is based by Bapsi Sidwa is based on a true story related to Sidwa, when she stayed at an army camp in the remotest region of the Karakoram Mountains with her family. Tehmina Durrani shocked the male-dominated society of Pakistan by describing her abusive and traumatic marriage to Ghulam Mustafa Khar, the then chief minister and later governor of Punjab, and her experience of a feudal society in her first book, which was written in Punjabi as Mere Jagirdar Aka and was later translated into English as My Feudal Lord. The book has been translated into 39 languages and has received many awards. She is regarded as a role model by many women in Pakistan for the courage she showed in writing this book. And her second novel, Blasphemy, is equally bold as her first book. Asma Jilani Jahangir is a leading Pakistani human rights lawyer and founding member of the Human Rights Commission of Pakistan. She had been the Secretary General and chairperson of this organization. She has shown incredible courage in defending the most weak section of Pakistani society, women, children, poor, and religious minority. Although she has been attacked and threatened, she has campaigned against law that discriminated women against women in her country. For the past three decades, Asma and her sister Hina Jilani have been at the forefront of both Pakistan's women and human rights movement. Both have been subjected to 24 hours a day surveillance by the state since 1996. She has written two books, Divine Sanction, The Hudud Ordinance, and Children of Lesser God, Child Prisoner of Pakistan. Kishwar Nahid, a feminist Urdu poet from Pakistan. She was born in Bulandshahr, India, and went to Pakistan after partition with her family. She has written six collection of book poems between 1969 and 1990. We Sinful Women is a well-known contemporary Urdu feminist poem of hers, and some of her poems have been translated into English as well. Asma Gul Hassan is an award-winning writer of Pakistan. She is the daughter of Pakistani immigrant Dr. Malik M. Hassan and Seema Gul Khan Hassan. Her book, Red, White and Muslim, is a biographical view of growing up as an American Muslim. She earned appreciation from fellow authors for this book. Raja Aslam says, a warm, witty, wonderful story about what it means to be both Muslim and American in a post 9/11 world. This is a book that every American should read. Hamida Shahid is a Pakistani sociologist and feminist human rights activist known for her extensive work on gender and class analysis and issues of rural development, labor, culture and religion in Pakistan. She was the UN special reporter for UN in the field of cultural right. Shahid has focused particularly on promoting and protecting cultural rights through policies and projects for marginalized communities, including women and religious and ethnic minorities. Feminism is Bangladesh. Bangladesh came into existence in 1971 when it was liberated from Pakistan. Bangladesh has closed the gender gap in primary education and it is now among the few countries in the world where the number of girls in high school is greater than the number of boys. Health facilities have increased in the country, and there is improvement in maternal and infant mortality rates. Women of Bangladesh are working in great numbers, mainly due to the growth of garment industry. The fact that there are over 3 million women paid employees in this sector alone has had a significant social impact on the society. Amartya Sen, the eminent economist, praised Bangladeshi record on gender equality by saying that Bangladesh has surpassed India's record in every aspects of human development index because of the investment in women's health and education. The Bangladesh constitution was considered a progressive document at the time of its drafting in 1972. It talked about equal right for all citizens irrespective of religion and gender. Religion's freedom and secularism as a pillar of the nation. There was a desire to create a new and better social milieu than the one left behind before the independence was from Pakistan, because it was earlier known as East Pakistan, being a part of Pakistan. But Article 28 has created a barrier to women's affluence, which says that women shall have equal right with men in all spheres of the state and of public life, but enshrines the application of Islamic law in family affairs, marriage, divorce, inheritance, and child custody. They are all determined by Sharia law, which was established by legislation in 1937 and amended in 1957 under Ayub Khan, President of Pakistan, which then included the territory that later became Bangladesh. The contradiction in the constitution granting equal rights to all citizens while allowing women's life to be directed by Sharia law is a block to social progress. There are two paths taken by the new trend. One is political, acted out through the Muslim-linked political parties in which women are playing active roles. The other is at the community and individual level, where women are interpreting religious scriptures for themselves. Women are not passive bystanders in the debates on Islam. Indeed, they are looking to it for their support, for their empowerment, and for issues like their freedom of movement, their going to school and work, their right to choose their husband, their legal rights to divorce and inheritance, and others laws. Today, Bangladeshi women are determined to interpret Islam on their own term. Islam offers protection from violence against women. The tradition that have cast women in subservient roles are not Islamic, but the product of male-dominated culture. and are misreading of the scripture. Women are seeking their Islamic identity as a source of empowerment and liberation. Taslima Nasreen is a Bangladeshi writer and former physician who is living in exile since 1994 on account of threats to her life. She started her career as a poet in 1980s and rose to global fame by the end of the 20th century because of her criticism of religion in her novels and essays. She is an advocate of secular humanism, gender equality, and human rights. With the publication of her novel Lajja in 1993, in which a Hindu family is persecuted by Muslims, her life and career changed dramatically. She suffered a number of physical and other attacks. An Islamic fundamentalist group offered a bounty for her death. She called for the abolition of the Sharia, the Islamic religious law. Having lived in exile in Sweden and India, she is now living in the US. Her books have been translated into 20 different languages. Tahmina Anam is another Bangladeshi writer, novelist, and columnist. Her first novel, A Golden Age 2007, won the 2008 Commonwealth Writers' Prize. It is about the Bangladeshi War for Independence and how it affects the destiny of its protagonists and in other individuals. Her follow-up novel, The Good Muslim, was nominated for the Man Asian Literary Prizes in 2011. It has a historical sweep that ranges from liberation war to the political turmoil, military coups and counter coups of two subsequent decades. It ends in 1992, just after Bangladesh re-established its parliamentary democracy, a happy ending of sort. The central conflict is the ideological and emotional bond between brother and sister. So all these women writers of India, Pakistan and Bangladesh and other human rights activists are striving hard to bring gender equality in the Indian subcontinent or South Asia, and we hope we will achieve our aim soon. Thank you.